They are skidful.
Hello, art family, and thank you to all the new subscribers. For this sketch, I am taking a look at some rocks at Mcconnells Mill here in Pennsylvania. So this is just off a hiking trail. Before I get started on the sketch, I wanted to take a minute to do a little value study, just to kind of get my ideas together and to see if I can take this very complicated idea and break it down into just 4 or 5 steps of value. And I'm using gouache here, but I'm treating it transparently, similar to watercolor, using a little scrap piece of watercolor paper from just the cut off piece from a larger page. And I've got this little kind of business card size thing, and I'm just working first with about 90% water. And I'm just asking myself what's the lightest, and then filling everything else in, and then going in and asking myself what's slightly darker, constantly closing an eye and squinting at it so that I can take this complex thing and break it down into large, simple shapes. Moving into the sketchbook here, I'm just staining the page, and most of this is kind of arbitrary colors, but I see this as a first attempt at a drawing. It's a chance to kind of get the big shapes down and blocked in with a color. I was kind of aware that if I'm using red in some areas, it might help to kind of give the green something to play off if it kind of shines through. But for the most part, these colors are arbitrary. I also used cooler colors in the distance, some cerulean blue, just to kind of push that area back. Ideally, you probably would want to work out all of the value ahead of time, but I've been doing this a while and I have my little value study, so I decided to go ahead and start with the background and work my way forward, still thinking about these large shapes. My goal is first to block in these very big shapes, and once I get all of those where I want them to be, I can start to subdivide into those shapes and look for those smaller shapes. For the water, I'm trying to pretend that the white foam on top of the water is not there at all. Just ignoring that completely, and just trying to imagine what it looks like underneath there. I'm aware, since it's water, that underneath it is going to be mostly greens, right? Because we have a reflection, that kind of mirrored reflection of the background, the distant bank, reflected on it. I also have light kind of moving through it, kind of going through the surface and bouncing around, creating a kind of glow. So I use a lot of green, fairly saturated, and parts with a lot of yellow ochre so that it gets that sense of luminosity. Then I'm closing an eye and I'm squinting and I'm just looking for those big shapes. I see this kind of dark patch, almost like shark teeth, these triangles that kind of go back. That's crucial because I want to keep in mind this sort of one-point perspective idea as we're going back. You think of like train tracks in your imagination, how they kind of converge together. I'm keeping that in mind with both the rocks and all the other shapes in this. They're going to get larger and broader as they get closer to me, and thinner and smaller as they go further back, kind of squishing as it gets close to the eye line. So I want to make sure I don't have a floating horizon. And since I put in those series of triangles in the distance, I can carry that dark value over to the left side, oscillating back and forth between warm and cool, and filling in that large shape before going yet slightly darker using ultramarine and burnt umber to kind of start to subdivide into that shape. What I'm doing is essentially picking apart these smaller things, these rocks and branches and things like that, but I'm not allowing myself to think about that. What I'm trying to do is just close an eye and squint at my reference, and I'm just hunting shapes. I'm looking for these big shapes first and then subdividing into these smaller shapes. Always constantly thinking about the drama that I can create with contrasts, both contrasts of color, so low saturated to high saturated, big shapes to small shapes, thin line with the branches to thick line on some other parts. I'm always thinking about these contrasts, red against the green, these opposites that play against one another that create a drama and an interest that help to draw the viewer into the scene, take the viewer to this place and this atmosphere. I'm also thinking about these low light areas in the shadows, these pops of cool blue where atmospheric light from the blue sky kind of fills in. It's not strong enough to illuminate quite like the sunlight, but it's there and it's able to create an ambient cool light in the shadows. So I'm going to use those for my upward facing planes in the shadow, and it'll give us some contrast too of color, some more color character to the scene. I increase the saturation on the moss because I want to make sure it's kind of bringing those rocks forward, and then I switched to this kind of filbert brush, kind of rounded flat, so that I could, it's very soft, so if I gently rake it across the surface, it creates this very textured, scumbled kind of look. So I'm going to try to use that to my advantage as I look for those small shapes, constantly closing one eye and squinting at the reference and seeing these kind of small diamond shapes that are created. Now I'm just looking to get all of my large shapes working, and then I wanted to bring a kind of excitement and a kind of animation to this scene. So I tried to run my fingers through the bristles of the filbert to flick white gouache onto the scene, but it didn't quite work, so I switch to a smaller round brush. I put some white paint on it and just flick it at the paintbrush. I have the benefit of having taken this photo, so I remember being there and the sounds that I heard, and I want to give that same sense of the environment to the viewer looking at this sketch. So flicking some of those little speckles and allowing some of that chaos to enter this scene will hopefully kind of bring the person there, so you can get more a sense of the kind of, the vitality and the speed of the water kind of rushing through this small corridor. At this stage in the sketch, it's largely done. I feel like most of the larger shapes are about where I want them to be, and at this point, you can just sort of noodle away at the detail forever. I mean, until it gets as close to the photograph as you want to take it. I'm trying to continue to add some detail here and there, as long as it adds to the image and where I want to draw the focus to, but I'm also trying to constrain the value as well into its groups. I'm going to do a little bit of work to add some foliage to the background and some clarity, but I want to make sure that I'm constraining that value so that it all stays together. I'm running basically my reference image through the kind of roadmap of my value study that I did right above the sketch, so that I can constantly keep an eye and make sure that I'm keeping things simple. It's very tempting to get in and kind of create so much detail, and you can kind of overwork a sketch or have too much contrast in areas where you don't want to draw focus to. I want to make sure I'm keeping the most of the drama and the contrast and excitement in the area that most interested me, which to me was this kind of swirling section where the water is sort of pinched between the rock to the right and the big rock to the center, and it creates this sort of little vortex that was sort of throwing water around, kind of interesting. At this stage, you're at about 80%. It's usually good to go ahead and pull the tape so you can get fresh eyes on your sketch. And if you don't tape it, then it's a good idea to leave the room and come back so you can see the sketch with new eyes and make sure that your values are working like you want them to. Well, that's going to be it for this sketch of some really big rocks and a rushing river at Mcconnells Mill in Pennsylvania. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.